thank you for coming today. This is the second of our Mautner lecture series. We had a wonderful lecture last night. We're making the same speaker work quite hard. She's coming back. I want to thank the family first. There's some members are sitting up front. They joined us last night, and we'll give them another good show today. I know I'm going to give a quick thanks to them, to our speaker for coming, but I don't introduce the speaker. We've got Professor Ted Robles, who's one of our faculty and a former student of hers, who's going to introduce her for us. But thank you for coming.
All right, well, welcome back to those of you who were here last night. Again, it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Kiecolt-Glaser as this year's Mautner Memorial Lecturer. Those of you who are here heard me talk about the various distinctions that she currently holds in terms of directing the Institute for Behavioral Medicine Research, et cetera. I will, for the purpose of time, skip some of those and talk a little bit more about her research. So she's been at the Department of Psychiatry at Ohio State for over 30 years. She's had over 250 publications, and the last time I checked, her H index was 98. She has dozens of federally funded grants, including 11 R01 or R01 equivalents, so like a project on a program project. And six of those 11 R01 equivalents were awarded in the past 10 years. And that, plus the publication record, I've had multiple conversations over the years with colleagues about what Jan's career has meant to many of us. And the words that always come up in those conversations are pioneer and trailblazer. And I've done the word counts, I've done the Luke analyses, and those are the words that come up all the time. As I mentioned last night, she was a central figure in launching human PNI research, was among the first to identify the stressors that she talked about last night in terms of caregiving, in terms of the marital relationship, which she'll talk about today. She talked about mind-body interventions as key contexts within which to explore immune function and health. She opened the door for many of us in this room as well, both in theory and research, making new discoveries that have become foundations for multiple areas of inquiry. And she continues to innovate. So if these 11 R01 or R01 equivalents could be considered the foundations of her research, she's also been awarded six R21 exploratory developmental grants over the years. And those have allowed her to literally put new floors on her research program, including some of the links she talked about last night with fast food, obesity, and inflammation. She'll be talking about close personal relationships in this talk, and it's an area that's been a constant in her career. Her most cited first authored paper is her landmark review in 2001 in Psychological Bulletin. That's been cited over 1,000 times on Google Scholar. Her work, which she's going to talk about today, was what really drove me to want to work with Jan as a graduate student. And I'm incredibly grateful, as I mentioned last night, to her guidance during graduate school and beyond. And I'm not alone in that gratitude. So last March in Denver at a conference, we were lucky enough, many of her current and former trainees were able to pose for a picture together with her. Many of the people in this picture are either literally or figuratively rising stars. The literal ones got an award. And thanks to Jan and her mentorship, we look like this most of the time in our research, rather than this. So just wanted to reiterate again, Jan, thank you for your pioneering, trailblazing work. I think all of us are appreciative of all that work. And personally, thank you for being a mentor, a colleague, and a friend through the years. So please join me once again in welcoming Jan.
The last time I actually gave a psychology department talk here was one of the more traumatic incidents in my life. It was back in the late 90s, and it was a time when we were still using slide trays, so that with the little 2x2 slides. So I was nervous. I really, really wanted to impress the group, as I do now, because it's a group of scholars that I so respect. So I had my slides all loaded and ready to go. The trays had a ring on the top that you would screw on so that they wouldn't fall out. I didn't pay attention to the fact that my slide tray did not have a ring. As people were filing in and I went to put my tray on the projector, I dropped the tray. My slides went all over the floor. As people were filing into the room, I was sitting there on the floor trying to figure out what slide was that and where should it go. I was trying to give the talk then, and the slides were not in the right order because I did it so hurriedly. So if something happens in my slides during this talk and I fall to the ground in a fetal position, I want you to know it is entirely rational behavior. So back in the 1980s, when Ron and I were first starting some of our work in psychoneuroimmunology, we were interested in what the health consequences were in terms of the immune changes we were finding. And so we had all these immune changes in the medical students during exams that I was talking about last night. But one of the things that we thought about was, let's look at a population that we know has greater health effects and see if there are immune differences. So we thought, well, there's this literature on separation and divorce in terms of acute changes in health, and that might be an interesting population to study. So we recruited a population of people who are recently separated and divorced, a couple of studies with both men and women. And also we got for comparison a married group as well. And the separated and divorced people did indeed have poorer immune function than their married counterparts. But within the married group, marital quality was associated with better immune function, better marital quality. So one Sunday I woke up, got the Sunday paper, and found that our work was on the comic pages. This posed an interesting problem for me. Is it good news or bad news if your work is cited in the comics? And if it is indeed good news, why doesn't it count on my citation count? So with that work, what we'd been doing, part of the question was, okay, so married people who were more happily married had better immune function, correlational data. But the issue was that marital quality was also associated with depression. People who felt their marriages were poor also tended to have higher levels of depressive symptoms. So we had a chicken and egg problem. What came first, and how could we sort that out? Because people could just say, well, if you're depressed, your marriage is unlikely to go well. Depressed people are often not fun to be around. And so that could be the case. On the other hand, if the most important relationship in your life is not going well, people don't tend to be overwhelmingly happy. And so it could go in that direction. To address that question, what we wanted to do was to get a group of people who were newly in their marriage, newlyweds, who were as pristine in terms of mental and physical health as possible. So we did this ridiculous kind of project where we were able to get access to marriage license records, and we pre-selected people who were in their first marriage within a certain age range. We followed up, we did a lot of phone interviews, and then we eventually got 180 people to come in and see us who represent 8% of the initial sample. So these are not a representative sample, as you might guess. And in fact, here are the exclusion criteria that meant we got so few people out of that group. We wanted people who were absolutely pristine in terms of mental and physical health, as much as we could tell. So we wanted them only between the ages of 21 and 40, only first marriages, no acute or chronic health problems. We didn't want any medications, and we didn't want birth control pills, but we also didn't want people to be planning to get pregnant in the next 2 years. So it turned out we had to do one or the other, so we took birth control pills. Minimal alcohol use, da-da-da-da-da. And so it took some time to actually collect that incredible sample. And when you do that, what you get is a sample that does not in any way represent the normal American population. They are very highly educated. The combined income was high for the 1980s, the late 1980s. They dated 3 years before marriage. They'd been married an average of 10 months. And they were very happy, the marital adjustment test in their marriage. So this is the kind of sample we were starting with. We also wanted to make sure we could control everything possible when we were going to be studying them. So we were going to be admitting them for 24 hours to the clinical research center, a hospital research unit, so we could really study them closely. So we had to do that only during the days 5 through 9 of the wife's menstrual cycle, an absolute disaster for scheduling, and all the other restrictions you see there. So they come in, And the first thing they do when they're going to be spending 24 hours with us is we put a catheter in their arm so we can draw blood across the 24 hours repeatedly without puncturing them each time, which otherwise would evoke a stress response. Then the arm you see there here has the line from the catheter going through back through the curtain back there. And what we have there are two nurses who are going to be drawing blood during their interaction repeatedly as they're talking. And we also have our psychology technician who's monitoring our videotape equipment. So what happens then is the couple is seated. They've each completed an areas of disagreement questionnaire where we've asked about common areas of marital disagreement, finances, in-laws, children. So then the interviewer sits down with them and says, okay, Mr. and Mrs. Smith, I know you've been talking about, I know that you each listed in-laws as an issue. Can you tell me about the last time you talked about in-laws? What the interviewer is trying to do is establish a couple of topics that are both hot and timely. So if they both agree they don't have any money, well, that's not much use if they don't really disagree about it actively. We wanted topics on which there was clear disagreement. So after about 20 minutes, then the interviewer would say, okay, it looks like here that what we have are a couple of areas that are clearly things that you have some disagreements about. You want to know what to do about Mr. Smith's mother, who keeps dropping by unexpectedly, and you're trying to decide whether you want to save money for a baby or buy a boat. In the next half hour, I want you to resolve one or both of these issues. And so then the interviewer would go behind the curtain, and the couple would be left to try to resolve one or both of the issues. When I'm talking about this kind of research, we have in the room Drs. Carney and Bradbury, who are people I've so looked up to and admired for so many years in research. So it's a little like bringing coals to Newcastle. If you really want to know about marital research, they are the folks who can really give you the scoop. In the kind of work we were doing, we were interested in the physiology. So we videotaped our couples while they're interacting. And what we're looking at here are negative behaviors because we also were able to score some positive behaviors, but that the negative behaviors in this study really carried the freight. They were really the most impactful on the physiology. And the kinds of behaviors that get scored are both verbal and nonverbal. So, you know, it could be that you say to your spouse, "You're such an idiot," which would be clearly a negative behavior. Or your spouse might say something and you roll your eyes dramatically. So we score that as well. And everybody was asked to disagree. So the issue here is not conflict is bad, because I think it's really important for people to do emotional housekeeping in a marriage. But what is also is the way it's done. So it's the difference between saying, "You're such an idiot," versus, "We really disagree on this, and we've had so much trouble figuring this one out," where you're not being punitive or nasty to the spouse along the way. So we were sitting, the team is sitting behind the curtain. The nurses are drawing blood as the couple is actually interacting. So we can actually look at the physiology as they're actually talking with each other. This is, Bill Malarkey was my colleague on this research, an endocrinologist who was just terrific in terms of helping us get this paradigm started. So baseline is when the interviewer sits down with the couple and says, "Okay, I noticed that you have two areas here that seem to be a hot spot for both of you." Begin conflict is when this interviewer says, "I'm going to go behind the curtain and I want you to resolve one or both of these issues." The middle of the conflict and then the end of the conflict, and then 30 minutes later. Well, and then this is simply, in this case, a median split, looking at high and low negative behavior in this case, not something I'd probably do these days. But what we found is that people who had lower levels of negative behavior, those behaviors you were seeing on the previous slide, tended to have a very different course in terms of epinephrine here. They went down over time. The people who were more negative had more of this kind of pattern. This stress hormone, a fight or flight hormone, is staying up. Here's norepinephrine, and you see much the same pattern. But even more striking here, the high negative group is still going up 30 minutes later. Norepinephrine is really important because it's one of those hormones that really can help activate the cascade to inflammation, So I'll be talking about inflammation again a little later. Oops, I'm really not good on this one. And so the changes here are particularly interesting. Here are ACTH data, another stress hormone, the same kind of thing. The group here, the high negative group, is coasting the entire time up here. The low negative group drops down nicely. So what we're seeing during the time the couple is actually talking with each other are real differences in how their stress hormones are behaving related to the way they're talking with each other. We also saw differences in immune function. We had blood for our immunological assays that we drew at the beginning of the day and at the beginning of the following morning after they spent 24 hours with us. Basically, this is an assay that's done in replicates, so you can look at any set of the bars. The low-negative folks, when they came into the CRC, and the low-negative folks when they left, really didn't change at all. The high-negative folks looked like this when they walked into the CRC, to the hospital unit, but this is what they looked like when they walked out. So across a battery of measures, what we saw over 24 hours, in concert with the endocrine changes we were seeing, was also a pattern of immune change in a negative direction. Well, we wondered if, in fact, what we might be seeing was a proxy for other things. Did negative behavior actually mean that there were other things going on that we weren't measuring? So we looked at a whole lot of other variables. Cardiovascular reactivity. Were these couples who were more negative just more reactive? No. Parental history of hypertension. Whole variety of health behaviors. Demographics, the time they dated, et cetera, et cetera. We also looked at a lot of self-report data. There were some very modest differences in terms of marital adjustment. The high negatives had a modest difference in terms of how they rated their marriage. The means are both well above the population average of 115. There were no differences in their support from other relationships, negative or positive affect, or social desirability. They differed on the way they were interacting with their spouse. The behavior was all we could see that was really driving the physiology that we were seeing. And this sample is really very happy is another thing to keep in mind. So the population mean is 115. This is our sample. So they're really skewed toward happiness. This is the first year of their marriage. That's not unusual. And in fact, only 3% of our sample scored in the range that we consider dissatisfied. So these are really happy people in the first year of their marriage, but we're still seeing the kinds of changes we're seeing. So we think in many ways that what we're seeing was actually a real underestimate for what happens. I really liked this study from Margolin and colleagues back when, where they actually had tape recorders in folks' homes and had them discussing conflicts. And in fact, no surprise, people are nastier at home when they don't have people behind the curtain listening to them. So what happened to those couples 10 years later? That was an interesting question for us that we really wanted to answer. Where did these people go? What happened to them in terms of the quality of their marriages? Well, 72 of the couples were still married. 17 were divorced. And that's about half of what we'd expect. But again, we had selected people who were so clean in terms of mental and physical health that we got rid of many of the risk factors that might lead to earlier divorce or other problems. We had one death, and we were able to get questionnaire data back on everybody who was still married. So the divorced couples versus the intact couples, and we also have data on those who were less and more happy, and the patterns are very similar, so I'll just highlight the divorce versus intact. The average time from the wedding to the divorce was close to 4 years. And that's pretty common in the marital literature. That becomes a point, an inflection point, where we see a lot of the divorces. They hadn't been significantly different in our year one data in a lot of things that might make a difference. They hadn't been different in how they rated their marital satisfaction in the first year. They hadn't been different in negative affect, in terms of personality kinds of issues, in terms of hostility or social desirability, family history of cardiovascular or psychiatric disorders. What we had were clear differences in baseline conflict behavior with greater negative reciprocity among the divorced. That's a behavior that's particularly pernicious in marriages. it's a tit-for-tat pattern where in a less functional marriage, one person says something, the other responds in kind, the other responds, the other responds. You really want that chain to be shut off early. You want one person to say, wait, let's talk, let's scale this down. When it keeps escalating, it's a real sign of danger, and you can see why. The more it escalates, the more people say things that can't get unsaid, and the nastier and worse it can be. And that was one of the things that then predicted divorce. But there were also baseline differences in our stress hormones that really mattered. I don't want to overwhelm you with data that I can summarize easily, so let me just say that when we looked back on terms of their hormone data during the interaction, during the conflict, there were differences between those who remained divorced and those who got divorced and those who remained married. But there was actually something even more interesting. So in this really odd, elaborate study, one of the things that we'd done was get hourly blood samples for 24 hours. The couple had a catheter in their arm with a line leading from it. So during the time the couple was awake, the nurse would come in and just flush the line and draw a blood sample. When the couple went to sleep, the nurse would creep in by the bedside, grab the line, and again draw a blood sample so that we could actually get samples when they were awake and when they were sleeping. And when we're looking here at the catecholamines, these flight or flight hormones, these stress hormones, what you can clearly see is that there were real differences in terms of here, the married versus divorced. The divorced were higher during the day, across the day, but they were also higher during the night when they were sleeping. For norepinephrine, there's no significant difference here, but during the night, again, they're higher. And norepinephrine, again, is one that I'll be relating to inflammation. So one of the questions that people ask often, well, is that simply a reflection of what was going on in the conflict? Are we just seeing the persistence of those changes during the conflict? And that's not likely. These two hormones have a half-life of a minute or two. And so when you're looking at those kinds of transient changes, you would have to have a huge, enormous difference during conflict to see these kinds of changes, and we didn't. And they would also have to persist much longer. So whatever we were seeing was not just during the conflict, but it was seeping out throughout the day and even during the night when people were actually sleeping. Well, we wondered if part of the issue, that part of what we were seeing in our couples, you know, in year one, was perhaps they were looking at each other as we're asking them to resolve the issue of the baby versus the boat. And they were thinking, if we can't resolve this issue, does this mean we're going to be one of the one in two couples who get divorced? And they were so unusual and so non-representative, we didn't know if this actually generalized to other populations. So we decided to recruit a sample of older couples that, in fact, had been married 42 years on average. And we looked, in a shorter version of what we'd done before, at their hormone changes, their stress hormone changes, their immune function during the CRC. And we saw much the same pattern. Again, even in couples who'd had the argument not just two times, but maybe 200 times about the in-law dropping in, we could still see changes in stress hormones over that time. And there were also real differences in terms of gender that I'm not going to go into today. That women, clearly, when we looked at our data and broke it down by gender, women had much clearer and larger rises related to the behavior during the conflict than men. We explained that by looking at a lot of the psychological behavioral literature, where it's clear that women remember marital disagreements and marital happiness more. Women have more detailed memories. There was a nice study where couples were asked to recall both detailed, but recall both happy times and unhappy times, and both the outside observers in terms of rating those and the couple agreed that women had far more detailed descriptions and memories. So if you have other studies where they've had couples rate negativity by looking at their own videotape, women see negativity much more sharply and much more clearly than men do. Women's ratings are concordant with those of the outside observers. men's were less so. So if, in fact, women see conflict more, remember it more, and respond to it more, then women would be at greater risk in more troubled marriages. And that was one of the things of great interest to us. Well, there had been a Psychbull article in 1992 that was really influential for me when I thought a lot about marriage and health. The marital studies, I'd been interested in close personal relationships and actual health consequences. But here, Berman and Margolin were making the point that to actually show that marriage was actually having an effect on health, you needed to first confirm that marital interaction had direct effects on physiology, and then show that the people who exhibited those changes were more likely to develop health problems. And there was no literature that actually made those links. So we wanted to see if we could make that link ourselves. So you heard last night, perhaps, that I really enjoyed wounding people. Well, we wounded a lot of people. As I mentioned before, wound healing really depends on the competence of the immune system. And stress has really large and reliable effects on wound healing. So we thought it would be an excellent model for looking at an objective and important health outcome. So I'd read about this really cool model in the literature. It's called a blister, a suction blister model. What you see here is a template that's strapped to the arm, and this tubing connects it to a suction pump. In this plastic plate here, similar to this one, there are 8 small holes. So when it's connected to this suction pump, over the course of an hour to an hour and a half, we're raising 8 small blisters on the forearm. People always wince when I talk about this study as well. I was blistered 2 or 3 times in the name of science. It's like someone gently pinching your arm during that time. But people do wince. Then after you've raised the blisters, the nurse takes off the top of the blisters, straps on the second plate you see down here, and is filling it with person's own serum so that over the next 24 hours, what we're going to be able to do is watch the evolution of the immune response at the wound site as people and look at actually what's happening in terms of the immunology that underlies wound healing at the wound site. And then we can assess repair of those blisters thereafter so we can actually look at the wound healing as well. So we had some healthy married couples again. During the first admission, we did the Passion-Bradbury social support interaction. This is a task where each member of the couple is asked to talk for 10 minutes about something about themselves they wish to change. So it might be that I want to become more organized, I want to eat more healthily, but it can't be a couple issue. So it has to be an individual issue. And the partner can respond to it however they wish. We were interested in both partners' behavior around those interactions. And then in the second admission, we had the same conflict and task that I talked about before, where people were asked to solve a disagreement. So in both admissions, we blistered people before the interaction. They wore those nice little wound chambers for 22 hours, and we could look at the evolution of the immune response over time by drawing off wells within those plates at certain intervals. And then we could assess blister wound healing daily to look at how long it actually took to heal those small blister wounds. Well, these are the self-report data. Pardon all the verbiage. I've learned to be better about slides, but this is an older one, sorry. When we looked at how negative affect when people were walking in the door. So when they came in for the first admission, they were more apprehensive and more anxious than when they came in for the second admission. And that really dropped off after they'd finished the discussion. In contrast, they came in less anxious. They already knew about being blistered and what that was going to be like. But after the discussion, negative affect was higher, though modestly so. And that's important for some of the rest of what I'll tell you about. These are cytokine data, and I can make it pretty simple in just 1 minute, that actually show what's happening at the wound site when we're sampling at 4, 7, and 22 hours. So we're looking at the evolution of the immune response over time. And what we see is that there's a difference across these three inflammatory markers in terms of inflammation. In this case, when we're talking about local inflammation in response to wounding, it's good. More is better in this case. Local is good. And what we're seeing, however, is that, for example, here, social support following conflict, we actually see that there are differences in terms of their ability to produce an inflammatory response in ways. And that the simply asking people to discuss a conflict has made a difference. And I think the effects are actually larger than what we have here. Looking back, you always know exactly what you should have done in your studies, and I should have randomized the order of those two interactions. But social support always came first. And so when people were actually more stressed and more anxious walking in, despite all this, we still see differences the second admission following conflict. And people healed more wounds, their wounds more slowly following conflict as well. We're following the blister wound healing, and people took a day longer, on average, following a conflict interaction than following the support interaction to heal exactly the same small standardized wound. Even that minor kind of intervention made a difference. But there were actual differences within couples, too, as you might expect. When we looked at people who were more hostile across both admissions or more nasty to each other, we found, in fact, that there were really larger differences even, that couples who were more hostile or more nasty healed at about 60% of the rate of those who were nicer and better to each other. It took them two full days more to actually heal their blister wounds on average than the couples who were able to discuss disagreements in calm and more reasonable kinds of ways. So we could actually show a link then between the physiology and the wound healing itself. So I've said before, so local inflammation is good if you're wounded. Systemic is bad, and they tend not to be correlated at all. Across several of our blister studies, we had no correlations. We had gone to NIH, to the clinical center, to learn the blister wound technique from a guy named John Galen in his lab, and they find no correlations. Whatever is going on locally is not reflected systemically. And what we found was that, in fact, people who were nastier or more hostile had greater systemic inflammation over 24 hours than those who were nicer to each other. And the differences could be quite striking at times. For IL-6, and again, it's just an important inflammatory marker is all you need to know about it. It jumped from 45% following social support task to 113% following conflict. So that the discussion of the conflict and the quality of that discussion made a real difference in inflammation 24 hours later. So what we could then show was that marital behavior was directly affecting physiology and wound healing. And there are several routes where that could happen, both in the session and overall. Marital distress basically can have clear effects on the endocrine and immune system, as we've seen before. But it can also do it indirectly over time in our lives by promoting depression, emotional stress responses, and detrimental health behaviors. So that we have multiple pathways to get to bad things with marital conflict. And one of the issues why marital conflict is so central and so important is your spouse should ideally be your major source of support. If your partner is instead your major source of stress because you're not getting along, then what you have is, in essence, a double whammy. You have the lack of support and stress, and you don't have real alternatives. In that case, you have a troubled relationship. And that's why marital distress, I think, can be so very potent and very important in people's lives and their health. So you saw this slide. You get it to see it again. Inflammation. So inflammation is associated with a lot of different age-related diseases. And what I've been showing you is the fact that when couples were behaving more nastily or more hostily toward each other, they had higher levels of inflammation the next day. So their behavior was actually tracking. There are now a number of cross-sectional perspective studies, including some nice work from Ted, that show that higher levels of inflammation are associated with more troubled marriages. That inflammation, it's one of the ways that marriages get under the skin and can actually cause health problems. You also saw a variation of this slide last night as well, because it's so important. Stress and depression are all really fuel things that are bad for us. Unhealthy diets, I'll tell you more about that again. Sedentary behavior, poor sleep, smoking, and alcohol abuse. What's interesting and important about it in this context are these are couple behaviors. Couples really share these behaviors. If you have a partner, it's typical that you would have dinner with them, so you have very similar diets. Sedentary behavior. People tend to have similar exercise schedules or lack thereof as their partner. It's unusual to find someone who's a real gung-ho athlete with a major couch potato. They tend to kind of converge together. Sleep is a big one. Again, Ted has done some nice work in this area, that when sleep is troubled, sleep may be troubled for both members of the couple. If one person is having sleep problems and they're tossing and turning, well, your partner's going to suffer as well. And smoking and alcohol, we have good data from a variety of studies from other labs showing that smokers tend to marry smokers, no big surprise. And alcohol abuse is also often a shared issue in couples as well. So depression is one of the big things that has really come out in the marital literature about how a troubled marriage can be so impactful in terms of depression, that it raises rates of major depression, that serious clinical depression, but it also increases even what would be considered more minor depressive symptomatology, and it's a bidirectional effect, as I was suggesting earlier. If you're depressed, people who are depressed tend to be less considerate, less able to connect with people. They're less pleasant to be around in many cases, which doesn't help the marriage. On the other hand, if your most important relationship is going very poorly, it's really hard to be happy. It's really a depression inducer. It impacts so many areas of our lives. So that one of the reasons that marriage is so important in our mental health is because it has these effects. And we were interested in how a depression history might act synergistically with marital distress. There are some very nice data, including some from Constance Hammond in this department as well. There are ideas that both currently and formerly depressed men and women have poorer family functioning than those without a depression history, and that those who have a depression history may experience more major and minor stresses, and past depression can boost emotional reactivity, including those to relationship stressors, so that people may already be primed to respond with a stronger and more forceful response when they're more depressed or when they have a history of depression. You heard this rap last night. When people are more stressed, they may turn to more comfort food. There are some nice rodent studies that suggest that, in fact, stressors will alter energy expenditure, and that monkeys fed a high-fat Western-type diet with chronic social stress will have increased visceral adiposity. So we wanted to look, in another of those interesting odd meal studies, at what happened with marital discord, past depression, and metabolic responses to high-fat meals. So we recruited people for a study where we were going to feed them bad food again. Married at least 3 years, no chronic health problems, they couldn't be diabetic or anemic, couldn't have virtually any medications. We wanted healthy couch potatoes who were overweight, so we wanted to maximize those dimensions. So we didn't, if they were within a normal weight range, they couldn't be exercisers. And we really wanted people who had BMIs higher than 25, and for them we really didn't want them to exercise very much either. So, and we were trying to prioritize unhappy couples. And this is a really hard thing to do because unhappy couples don't usually want to come in for your research studies. They really don't want to sit there and talk about problems in their relationships. But we did manage to get some. And one side note here, people often ask, do couples discuss real life things when they're sitting there and they know other people are behind the curtain? I have been truly amazed at some of the conversations that we've had. In this study, one of the one of the oddest ones actually revolved around the fact that we had monitors on to measure heart rate variability with a polar watch, and the polar watches had been given names so we'd know which watch went with which monitor. And it turned out that one of our husbands was wearing a monitor named Carmen, and his wife got really snippy and angry about that. And we later found out what was going on was, in fact, he had a mistress named Carmen.
Oh, no.
And that this created some tensions that went throughout the day. In another case, and this is the only time that's happened in our research, we actually had a couple separate after the first session. And what they talked about was the husband was working two jobs, the wife was not working. She talked about how she wanted to find something that was really fulfilling. He was saying, I need some help with the bills. And that conversation, we don't know, may have been instrumental or not, but they didn't come back. But we really had some conversations where I kind of went, oh my gosh. It's hard to listen at times when people get so nasty to each other. It's generally the exception rather than the rule, but we really do see some real life difficult conversations. So it's a double-blind, randomized crossover studies. They're both going to get the bad meals. We're going to draw blood from them repeatedly over time, and we're going to ask them to discuss a disagreement 2 hours after we've given them the meal because we wanted them, we were looking at when I asked my nutritional colleagues, when is the best time to maximize what we're seeing in terms of interference with metabolism? And that was their best advice. So briefly, you saw this last night. We gave them two unhealthy meals. In this study, it didn't matter which one they got. The effects we were seeing didn't change. If you weren't here and didn't get to hear all this wonderful stuff last night, the meals we're feeding them are relatively high in calories and high in fat, but they're modeled after fast food meals. So we're looking at the equivalent with our couples of giving them a fast food meal and then looking at what happens metabolically with them. So same thing, they come in, they get a catheter, they eat our lovely breakfast, scrambled eggs, sausage gravy, and biscuits. The interviewer, Lisa Jerimka, my wonderful postdoc, who's now at the University of Delaware, is sitting down with a couple to say, now, Mr. Smith, I notice you and Mrs. Smith both have the same issue here. And then the couple is set to talk about their disagreement. So when we look at the data from this study, it is quite similar in some ways to what we saw from the study last night as well. So when we have people who have a history of depression and hostile marital interactions, they have lower resting energy expenditure across that six-hour period after the meal when they're in the clinical research center. And the difference over that six-hour period accounts to about, in this case, 118 calories per day, and that could account for anywhere from 7 to 12 pounds per year if this kind of stress was happening every day on a regular basis. It's small in a single time frame. It's big over time. Again, when we had the combination of past depression and more hostile behavior, insulin was higher at the first post-meal. Insulin, high insulin is a way to store fat. So when people have higher insulin, in this case, following the meal, it's encouraging fat storage, which is not what we want to do. And there are differences here in triglycerides. So when you eat a high-fat meal, your triglycerides, the fat rises in your blood. You want it to rise as little as possible and go down as rapidly as possible, because this fat in your blood can eventually clog arteries. It's bad for you in a lot of ways. And what we see is that people, again, who had, this was similar to the data last night as well, but I don't think I talked about it, the combination of negative behavior and depression went up and stayed up more than the other three groups. Well, those data really dovetail with some other data from other investigators about cardiovascular risk kinds of markers. Here we have atherosclerosis, where that in data from Linda Gallo and her colleagues, that when she was looking at women in satisfying marriages relative to those in low satisfying marriages, there were real difference in atherosclerosis. And there were both cross-sectionally and longitudinally. So satisfied women here had lower, clearly lower levels than the dissatisfied, the unmarried are here. When we look at them 11 years later, we see the pattern again with the unmarried coming down a bit. So that the marital satisfaction is associated with an important marker for atherosclerosis. And there's another study that shows the same kinds of effects in another way, a recent one, with intima medial thickness. Looking here again at positive merit, in this case, they're looking at marital interaction quality in both positive marital interactions and negative marital interactions and by tertiles. And so the more positive the interaction, the lower the level of intima medial thickness. The higher the negative quality, the negative interaction quality, the higher the level of intima medial thickness. So we can see how the data that we have in terms of our meal studies actually can translate into health effects that other people are seeing. We have mechanistic pathways from the quality of the marriage to the quality of one's health over time, importantly. Well, dieting with your partner is a common daily event, and we talk about this a lot. We have Janet Toniamo should actually be up here talking about this part, about how high-fat comfort food can be so very enticing, especially during stressful times. And part of what we found so interesting about the study was that, in fact, what we were seeing only emerged following meals. When we looked at people before the meal, we didn't see differences related to depression or hostility, even though hostility, I think, is a constant, and I don't think that's, I think it's a highly reliable behavior. But it took feeding people the meal to actually see the metabolic differences. So we've always tended to measure people when they were fasting for many of our studies. For metabolic changes, we really need to feed people. We need to perturb the system and see what will actually happen to them under those circumstances. And we think, again, these underestimate the effects. We're giving people one meal and looking at what happens. But here's our daily life. We start out, we have breakfast, we have lunch, we have dinner, and then we're finally fasting again. So that over the course of the day, what we have are a series of metabolic changes related to what we're eating, and especially how those effects that we're seeing following a single meal could actually be accentuated over time with those kinds of changes. So I talked about this last night, and so the quick version is the data sound weird and odd, but they are actually quite similar to the data I was showing you last night on women. That in both cases we're seeing that stressors, here a marital stress, in that case a daily stressor, are associated with alterations following people's meals. Well, when we look at metabolic consequences of troubled relationships and marriages, we know that marital dissatisfaction and poor quality are associated with, for example, the development of the metabolic syndrome in women. The metabolic syndrome has as its cornerstone visceral adiposity, gut fat. And that we know that being depressed raises the risk of weight gain and depositing visceral fat, so that we can see pathways through what we see in the laboratory to some of the effects that are longer term and more important in terms of health. So in troubled marriages and depression, basically we have evidence for how we could have pathways to cardiovascular disease, to metabolic syndrome, and also to diabetes through the kinds of metabolic alterations we're seeing. And in fact, there are marital data on each of those, as you saw some of that show, in fact, that poorer marriages raise the risk. So very briefly, in a few minutes, I just want to talk about some of the new ideas that we've been playing with. This is an annual review of clinical psychology paper that I wrote with Stephanie Wilson, a really outstanding postdoc in my lab. And when I was asked to write the review, I was thinking, my gosh, how am I going to say anything new? Because Ted had a really marvelous psych bull paper in 2014. And I thought, this is really going to be impossible. Because I can't just parrot what he said back when. So I was trying to find new ways to think about marriage and how marriage would make a difference. And so we started looking at a lot of the data on emotional transmission, shared behaviors and experiences, something I was talking about with Rena Repetti that I think is really provocative. So people typically choose their partners who are very similar in terms of attitudes and demographics. And our daily lives are really intertwined. If your spouse is unhappy, you may well be unhappy as well. You have similar attitudes, behaviors. You have stressors that affect both of you oftentimes, and lifestyle. And there are strong mutual influences, diet, physical activity, smoking, alcohol consumption, and body mass index. What's kind of surprising in that there's this large literature that I was finding about spousal concordance for major coronary risk factors, for blood pressure, for triglycerides, for cholesterol, smoking, body mass index, and the waist-hip ratio. So that those things are actually tend to be more concordant in relationships. But that actually wasn't the most interesting thing. I went more into the literature, and I was looking at concordance across a whole variety of health behaviors. And there was a really interesting and odd literature that I had not met before that I find quite fascinating and provocative. So diabetes, spousal diabetes risks is increased 26%. That I can understand. You know, if both members of the couple have the same diet and it's an issue and they're both sedentary, well, we could see that. But when we get to something like arthritis, spousal odds almost triple. Or physician-diagnosed hay fever, spousal risk is more than twice as great, and the risk increases with the time living together. So if your spouse has hay fever, it increases your risk for hay fever. Or asthma, peptic ulcer disease. So that whatever couples are doing together and their shared environment may have really important and interesting consequences for a whole variety of areas. Well, what might be going on in some of that? This is our newest study that we're just getting underway, the gut feeling study, marriage, mood, and the gut microbiome. Well, we're trying to look at the gut microbiome as potentially a major mediator or pathway for much of what we're seeing here. It's a study that's just in early days. I have nothing to talk about. I don't know a lot about the microbiome, though I hope to know a whole lot more within a year. And this is my pitch to the students here. I'm interested in postdocs who might be pursuing these kinds of interesting questions as well, because UCLA has such fine students. And I have to say, when I was meeting with the graduate students earlier, three of those graduate students in the room had also applied to Ohio State, and they'd come to UCLA instead. So you have to give me something back. Again, I'll briefly say I live professionally in a wonderful institute that I'm very proud to direct. The kinds of work I'm doing would not be possible were it not for my wonderful colleagues in the IBMR. And those are people I really want to recognize. For the major studies I've been describing, you saw people listed before earlier, but Ron Glaser, my husband, Lisa Jeremka, my recent postdoc, Rebecca Andridge is our wonderful biostat colleague, as is Yuan Ping, Chris Fagundes, a recent postdoc, Bill Malarkey, endocrinologist extraordinaire, and Martha Baluri, a nutritional colleague. If you're interested in any papers from our lab, you can find them there. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.